Hello world, it's Siraj, and let's learn about a popular new deep learning framework called PyTorch. The name is inspired by the popular Torch deep learning framework, which was written in the Lua programming language. Learning Lua is a big barrier to entry if you're just starting to learn deep learning, and it doesn't offer the modularity necessary to interface with other libraries like a more accessible language would. So, a couple of AI researchers who were inspired by Torch's programming style decided to implement it in Python, calling it PyTorch. They also added a few other really cool features to the mix, and we'll talk about the two main ones. The first key feature of PyTorch is imperative programming. An imperative program performs computation as you typed it. Most Python code is imperative. In this NumPy example, we write 4 lines of code to ultimately compute the value for D. When the program executes C equals B times A, it runs the actual computation then and there, just like you told it to. In contrast, in a symbolic program, there is a clear separation between defining the computation graph and compiling it. If we were to rewrite the same code symbolically, then when C equals B times A is executed, no computation occurs at that line. Instead, these operations generate a computation or symbolic graph, and then we can convert the graph into a function that can be called via the compile step. So computation happens as the last step in the code. Both styles have their trade-offs. Symbolic programs are more efficient since you can safely reuse the memory of your values for in-place computation. TensorFlow is made to use symbolic programming. Imperative programs are more flexible since Python is most suited for them, so you can use native Python features like printing out values in the middle of computation and injecting loops into the computation flow itself. The second key feature of PyTorch is dynamic computation graphing, as opposed to static computation graphing. In other words, PyTorch is defined by run. So at runtime, the system generates the graph structure. TensorFlow is define and run, where we define conditions and iterations in the graph structure. It's like writing the whole program before running it, so the degree of freedom is limited. So in TensorFlow, we define the computation graph once, then we can execute that same graph many times. The great thing about this is that we can optimize the graph at the start. Let's say in our model we want to use some kind of strategy for distributing the graph across multiple machines. This kind of computationally expensive optimization can be reduced by reusing the same graph. Static graphs work well for neural networks that are fixed size, like feedforward networks or convolutional networks, but for a lot of use cases, it would be useful if the graph structure could change depending on the input data, like when using recurrent neural networks. In this snippet, we're using TensorFlow to unroll a recurrent network unit over word vectors. To do this, we'll need to use a special TensorFlow function called while loop. We have to use special nodes to represent primitives like loops and conditionals because any control flow statements will run only once when the graph is built. But a cleaner way to do this is to use dynamic graphs instead, where the computation graph is built and rebuilt as necessary at runtime. The code is more straightforward since we can use standard for and if statements. Anytime the amount of work that needs to be done is variable, dynamic graphs are useful. Using dynamic graphs makes debugging really easy since a specific line in our written code is what fails, as opposed to something deep under session.run. Let's build a simple 2-layer neural network in PyTorch to get a feel for the syntax. We start by importing our framework as well as the autograd package, which will let our network automatically implement backpropagation. Then we'll define our batch size, input dimension, hidden dimension, and output dimension. We'll then use those values to help define tensors to hold inputs and outputs, wrapping them in variables. We'll set requires gradients to false since we don't need to compute gradients with respect to these variables during backpropagation. The next set of variables we'll define are our weights. We'll initialize them as variables as well, storing random tensors with the float data type. And since we do want to compute gradients with respect to these variables, we'll set the flag to true. We'll define a learning rate, then we can begin our training loop for 500 iterations. During the forward pass, we can compute the predicted label using operations on our variables. MM stands for matrix multiply, and clamp clamps all the elements in the input range into a range between min and max. Once we've matrix multiplied for both sets of weights to compute our prediction, we can calculate the difference between them and square it. the sum of all the squared errors, a popular loss function. Before we perform backpropagation, we need to manually zero the gradients for both sets of weights, since the gradient buffers have to be manually reset before fresh gradients are calculated. Then we can run backpropagation by simply calling the backward function on our loss. It will compute the gradient of our loss with respect to all variables we set requires gradient to true for. Then we can update our weights using gradient descent. And our outputs look great. Pretty dope. To sum up, PyTorch offers two really useful features: dynamic computation graphs and imperative programming. Dynamic computation graphs are built and rebuilt as necessary at runtime, and imperative programs perform computation as you run them. There is no distinction between defining the computation graph and compiling. Right now, TensorFlow has the best documentation on the web for a machine learning library, so it's still the best way for beginners to start learning. And it's best suited for production use since it was built with distributed computing in mind. But for researchers, it seems like PyTorch has a clear advantage here. A lot of cool new ideas will benefit and rely on the use of dynamic graphs. Please subscribe for more programming videos, and for now, I've got to torch my hair, so thanks for watching.